reefs will cease to exist by mid-century.
Yep, 35 years from now.
Can they still exist off of what remains?
Sure.
Once this part of the world is hungry, I mean, where do we go?
So you're talking then about a population of
at least about 380 million, maybe.
People.
Yeah, I think that's about the ballpark.
I'm back in the US. So often these things seem so far off, whether in time or geography. But in the Pacific Northwest, the shellfish industries continue to struggle as far south as San Francisco. In Maine, there are similar reports of dwindling oyster populations. Ocean warming is causing lobsters off the coast of Connecticut and Rhode Island to move north, devastating local economies that depend on them. Perhaps most alarming is what is happening in Florida. Ocean acidification wasn't supposed to have an effect there for another 50 to 60 years. But scientists at the University of Miami are discovering that coral is already dissolving at a rapid pace. Ocean acidification and warming, they're happening here. Confronted with the information that we are altering our oceans forever, what do you do?
It's still, even with the things that I've seen, hard for me to look at that ocean, that broad expanse that I've grown up on my entire life, and conceive that my actions can have a meaningful impact in there.
Your actions times 7 billion. And we should realize that we are totally connected to the natural world, and our highest responsibility must be taking care of the systems that take care of us.
What can we do? How do we mitigate the effects of what I just witnessed?
The more that we destroy the natural systems, the more rapid the accelerating warming will take place. So I have a map here.
Dr. Sylvia Earle is one of the world's foremost oceanographers. With her organization, Mission Blue, Sylvia has created a global network of hope spots, ocean areas designated for special protection. And many of those areas have become marine protected reserves, shielded from fishing and pollution. Scientific studies are beginning to show that certain marine animals may be able to adapt to the pressures of climate change, and these areas give them the best possible chance. All of these protections seem like a great thing, but I don't see how any of it is going to stop the oceans from acidifying and warming.
So how can these, just simply put, how can these marine protected areas affect climate change?
The truth is that alone, they cannot. We are at a crossroads, and our job right now with rising CO2 is how do we stem the flow of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere? If we put a price on carbon, that causes people to say, oh, nature is not free. It's making those generators of carbon, the burners mm-hmm. of fossil fuels on the large scale, do something about it.
Sylvia's telling me that the only real solution to ocean warming and acidification is the biggest solution of all, decarbonizing. And putting a price on carbon pollution will encourage people and companies to create less of it.
People ask me, what is the biggest problem facing the ocean today? The biggest problem is not what we're putting in or taking out. It's ignorance. It's ignorance. We know we can change, and we have to. We can do this.
I went into this journey looking to understand more about the ocean I've always loved. I've learned about a crisis, complex, overwhelming. Now, every cell of my being wants to be a part of the solution. I'm going to fight for a price on carbon. And in the meantime, I'm going on expeditions with conservation group Oceana to help educate people on the importance of our oceans and combat the very ignorance Sylvia said was the biggest threat to our survival.
Whoa.
Oh my God.
It's a small piece of the solution, and I'm going to do more. We all have our part to play. What's yours?